This is Bill Shankly.
Oh, yeah.
The legendary football manager of Liverpool Football Club. He was passionate about football. And he's a colorful character. He was a colorful character. He's passed away. But one of his, one of the quotations is that, he said, some people believe football is a matter of life and death. He said, I'm very disappointed with that attitude. I can assure you it's much, much more important than that. As I was preparing, thinking of what to say, all the time this quotation came back to my head. That the sort of almost irrational passion that he had for football, I seem to have for XML, which is a little bit sad. It's not quite the same. I can't imagine someone at the football conference saying, this is Kabe, he was passionate about XML. But the other way around it works. This is someone else I'd like to mention. This is John Gardner, a guy I'm privileged to say I know. He is a physicist, well-known solid-state physicist in Oregon, I believe, University of Oregon. At the age of 48, he had an eye operation which went wrong. And he went blind, completely blind. So after recuperation, he went back to work, wanting to work, and he had great difficulty because he could no longer, clearly he couldn't read, but he couldn't read the papers. He couldn't, the only way was to have someone sitting by him and reading the papers to him. Now, he's done great. He's got a company called ViewPlus, I believe. You can Google him. And he makes printers. Some of you may know he makes special printers that'll take, say, a bitmap image, which obviously a blind person can't see, and it prints it in relief, so a bit like Braille, so people can see. And he's also got another product where if you had a graph in SVG, then you can, by moving over the SVG file, it would change the pitch according to how high the graph is, so you could tell the shape of the curve. So very, very ingenious guy. But the point is that he, because he lost his sight, suddenly he couldn't continue his work. The publications were completely opaque to him. So my question is, the stuff that you're publishing today, can John Gardner read those, or can he consume those? Can he? And if not, well, we should do something about that. We have the technology for the blind, I don't know if that's politically correct these days, but I'll say blind, because he can't see, or the visually challenged, to read, if you like, to consume your publications. And if you're not doing that, well, I think you should look at why. What is needed is good structured XML. So what you need is a description of your content, not a rendering of your content. And you must have 100% confidence in your content. The confidence that you have in your XML should be greater than that you have in your PDF. It's more important than the PDF. Because in future, that XML could be used to render something else. If you proofread your PDF, but you're not quite sure about the XML, there's going to be trouble in future, I believe. So somehow, you need to have your XML should be really the most important thing that you produce. The way to do that is to use an XML first workflow. So you create an XML first, and from that you create other things. Now, I talk to people who say, have you checked your XML? They say, yeah, we've checked it. How have you checked it? Well, parse it and we get a, you know, green tick mark, so it's okay. But the parsing is not enough, because parsing, it's a bit like going to a museum and say, are you sure about, you know, we want to archive all our paintings. So you check that. The parser is just checking the frame. It's not checking the content. The parser is checking the tags around your content. So it's saying P for paragraph, a lot of text, slash P, paragraph is finished. It says, yeah, these P's are in the right place. But it doesn't know anything about what's inside it. So that'll parse, but the parser actually looking only at the frame. So this one passes too. This is just as good. Sorry about the content, but that's just as good. I was going to make a joke about the arse would pass, but I thought it really wouldn't be.
It's too heavy for this.
It's a little bit much here.
I think
I will. I'd resist the temptation. Yes. Yes. Is the pronunciation? Let's move on, shall we? So. Everyone has XML. All the clients want XML, full XML. But actually, I can't get hold of it. They're not publishing it. Only a few people. The one or two open access PLOS publishes their XML. It's a question I have. If I buy a paper from you, I'd like to get the XML too. Just a few examples. Now, I don't know if you've looked at XML, looks a little bit intimidating. But open an XML, and even if you're not, I mean, I'm not an expert about the details of XML, but you can actually, it's quite easy to see, and most text editors will color it for you, so you can see the content and the tags. This is valid XML, this is actually the NLM mixed citation coding for references. So you can see the year is 2005, volume is 5, etc. But what it's doing in between is putting the punctuation into, it's putting the brackets, hard coding the bracket either side of the year. It's putting a colon here, it's putting an end dash between the first page and the last page. Now, personally, I don't like to see punctuation. XML is supposed to be content, right? Now, just assume John Gardner had a reader for the blind. He's listening to this, and it says, open bracket, year 2005. Close bracket. We know it's year 2005. That bracket is a visual rendering, and it should only appear when you render it. So that's one example. You should use, the XML should be clean. And just data. This is another thing I found there weren't many XMLs on the web, but I've downloaded a few. First page 341. And it's not, you could look at this. I mean, you don't have to be, you know, a 6-year-old can see that that's wrong. If the first page 341, the last page can't be 54. But why is it like that? Because in print it's 341-54, because that's a convention. Okay? So the lazy typesetter has said, oh, well, it's easier, we just put in the XML. But then you've got bad data. So again, let's see, John Gardner is listening. Oh, first page 341, last page 54. Something wrong with that. Okay? Bill nodding, that's what gives me energy. I must be doing something. I've been parsed by Bill. So this is another one I see. Every displayed equation has a paragraph before and after. A displayed equation is actually part of a paragraph. So if I say, as we see, A equals B, therefore, that's not three paragraphs. That's one paragraph. Now, if you print that, it looks fine, but again, a blind person sees a paragraph before and after. This is, all right, why is this person starting an equation with a paragraph? So these are the little details. These should be right. This is more important than what you see PDF. In 3 years' time, there is no PDF. Everyone's looking at their iPads, turning it round and round. Right, guys. Nightmare scenario. You are the publication director, and important meeting, and a geeky IT guy knocks on the door. He says, look, we've got a problem. He said, well, come on. You know, I'm in an important board meeting here. Go away. He says, look, please, please. Takes you aside, and he said, it could be a she, but it's probably a he. Says, we've got a major problem. All our 5 years past data, you know, we've got the XML and all the assets like videos, the audio, pictures, etc. It's on one disk, and we've got backup. And all the other stuff, the PDF, HTML, EPUB, anything that we've actually published is on another disk. Now, the problem we've got, there's a computer, some sort of problem somewhere. I've got to pull the plug on one of these, and there's no way around it. You're going to lose either all the XML or all the other stuff. You've got half an hour to make a decision. Poor Natasha is frowning in the front, going, oh, my God. Hey, someone's got the right answer. Right. So, what is the answer? What would you say? I mean, hand on heart. Would you do that, Natasha? This is being recorded, so. So, that's the end of my talk, really. Thank you for ruining my talk, then.
You convinced her over coffee.
She's being bribed. So, the correct answer is, yeah. We don't need that anymore because we can press the button, out all it comes. So I'm going to make sure that your PDFs are going to be deleted tomorrow because you said it's fine. Because if you are truly creating XML first, you can just recreate them again. That's a nice thing. What is XML first? Now, I have to thank my mentor, Bill, for this because I think it was, am I right, the recent blog post you commented that it's what is XML first, it's the interpretation. Thank you very much. So this slide is
dedicated to you.
Dedicated to yourself, Bill. Well, there's what we call pure XML first, which is you take XML, you press a button, hands off the keyboard, PDF comes up. We're just saying PDF, but it could be EPUB, it could be HTML5, it could be whatever, some rendered thing. Or it could be audio, it could be EPUB 3. XML first, it could be, oh, I've got XML, I'm going to create PDF, but a few tweaks just to put the, you know, just to get it, obviously, pagination, this and that, well, God knows what. So that's another XML first. And the other extreme is XML first. I make the XML, I go and have breakfast, have a cup of tea, then I make PDF. I made XML first, but there's no link between them, right? That's the other extreme. People will tell you that. So please be careful. When they say XML first, what I'm talking about is fully automated XML first with no manual hands off the keyboard. Demo. Bill Shankly, are you looking down at me? Please make this work. Okay. I'm going to do a little magic trick here, as we're all in a good mood now. Hopefully stay that way. This is an XML file. It happens, it could be any, this is Elsevier DTD, as it happens, DTD, they're one of our clients, small publisher you may have heard of, Amsterdam. Oops. Okay, got a name. I just want to change, can someone give me a surname just to show this is a live demo? Jones? I've got a Jones here already. Can I have another one, please? Your wish is my command. Okay. I've got another name here. Another name, please. Oh. All right. Right. So that's a XML file, we've said. Now, just while we're here, you see, this is relatively clean. There's no punctuation here. First page is 683. Last page is 710. Correct. So you can imagine, just imagine some sort of reader for the blind. It says main title nonlinearity. Simple as that. Volume is 22, date is 2009, etc., etc. Yeah. If you look closely, I'm sure you find some errors, but let's hope not. So it's a you can see it's sort of relatively it reads nicely. Yeah? No punctuation. This is all the math that it taken a sort of complex paper just to show the. So there'll be a lot of MathML. Okay, so all the math is in MathML. All right, I'll save this. And what I'm going to do is I run. I say make all. That's the details of what's happening is not important. It's that what's happening is that that XML is fully automatically running through some sort of process, hands off the keyboard, and it's created a PDF. Okay? There's no manual intervention. It's creating another PDF. It's going to create a few files.
Eight minutes to go?
8 minutes should be fine. Okay. So while it's producing those, it's about 6 or 7 seconds, and that's on a 2-year-old laptop, so obviously on a server that would be different. So let's see what we've got. Watkins in there, so that is a live demo. So the references, we got the references in numerical. It's the same. There's nothing in the XML to say whether it's numerical references, whether alphabetical or numerical. That is a rendering question. So you shouldn't say anything about in your XML. That's the idea. If you go to the references, so we've got Baz again here. Let's see. So say Bender M, McNamara V, and you got an ampersand here, Raynor. The non-linear NLRW, that's in italic, and the date is at the back 2007, and the range 939 to 958. Okay, so it's a two-column paper, double-column paper. Let's open this one. Okay, let's close that. It's the same thing, Watkins. This is single column. Yeah, single-column paper. Now, the references here are alphabetical. They link to the end, Baz again here, and they are sorted alphabetically. Desi happens to be repeated, so the convention is you put an N dash here, M dash rather. And then here you have the first name, then the initial, comma, initial, then the surname, initial surname, etc. It's completely different, right? So if I now open, there's another one here. This one is right similar, but this time now the numbers are in superscript, and it's footnotes. Okay, the references come out as footnote. Baz again here. Okay, and this time let's see. Anyway, it's the point is everything is it's got a slash between the names here. Whatever. So really, the look of the paper should have nothing to do with your XML. The XML. This is true XML first. That's the way things should be. Now, if I just open these two again, can I see any difference? If I close that, open together, close that, okay. One thing here is, if you look at this, very similar, but here you got 939 to 958, here you got 939 to 58. Each one's got a different convention. So you put the data correctly, but the renderer will contract it, as it were. Right, what else have we got? Just to show different things that you can do. This is exactly the same thing, fully automatically. This is standard PDF reader, right? There's nothing. But what we've got here is a sort of clickable list of contents here. These are links that go elsewhere, and these are cooked into the PDF, and it opens full screen. Just to show you can do different things. Okay, this is a bit for fun, but every other word is gray. Okay? Fully automatic. This sort of thing you can do fully automatically. Now, it may be a bit, sort of, you know, a bit of fun. However, it may be useful. People who have dyslexia, they may see things better if they're rendered in a different way, because they can't see word endings, I think, I'm not sure. But anyway, the point is, from an XML, you can create anything. For example, there's a font just recently was created for dyslexia, which is slightly sort of bottom heavy. Let's see another one, and this one is really wacky. Exactly the same file. The problem considered in the following pages is what is sometimes called properly typeset. All the maths is correct. So, going round and round and round, and the colors are random. Just to show you can do it. Okay? Now, you might say, well, I don't want my, you know, this is, you don't want our content to be read this way. Well, why not? It let users read things the way they want. You might want one paragraph on each page. Let them do it. So this is how things should be. However, if your XML is not quite right, you can't do this. If your XML is perfect, you can do this. Now, we don't check XML. If you're true XML first, you shouldn't have to check it, because effectively you're checking it here, right? Yes, the tags may not be right. There are ways of doing that, but at least the content, every single minus sign, etc., is right. So that's my demo. So let's think outside the box. The job of the publisher, the main job I feel, is to create content, good content. We've sort of diluted that. Everyone's talking about what kind of HTML, what kind of CSS, what's the next e-reader to come, and you're not thinking about the content. Well, if you create good content in XML, any reader can read it. It doesn't matter what comes around the corner. In 10, 20 years' time, that XML can be converted. Don't worry about devices. Then it begs the question, do we need a house style? You saw several styles come out. So I would like to suggest that we dump the house style. Someone said, hey. So what is the point of it? You know, you want things to look that way, but I remember it's a long time since I did proper research, but I was researching. I preferred numerical references. Certain journals were really nice because it didn't interrupt my reading. Well, how about me choosing how I want my references? So you put your XML up there, I press the button, the server, okay, and there could be third parties who take your, I've paid for it, take your XML, convert it, give it to me the way I want. That would be great. That's the sort of vision. 2 minutes to go, guys. So why not publish just the XML? So Bill Shankly, in a sense, I feel, at the beginning, I thought, oh, that's a bit of, what a funny thing to say. But what he was saying was football was so important to him, so important to the, if you like, the working classes around Liverpool, that he's dead, he comes and goes, but he did his bit to keep football alive. And Liverpool Football Club is much better now than after he started. So I feel our job is to make sure, it's not what we do, our jobs is to make sure that that content is passed on up with perfectly to the next generation. Otherwise, they're going to have trouble. Thank you.